better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in man. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in princes. I was pushed back and about to fall, but the Lord helped me. Shouts of joy and victory resound in the tents of the righteous. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. The Lord's right hand is lifted high. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. I will not die but live, and will proclaim what the Lord has done. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. I know that my Redeemer lives, and that in the end he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. For none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. And Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live, even though he dies. And whoever lives and believes in me will never die. You may be seated for our first hymn. Let us stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of all mercy and the God of all consolation. He comforts us in all our sorrows so that we can comfort others in their sorrows with the consolation we ourselves have received from God. In holy baptism, Adolf was clothed with the robe of Christ's righteousness that covered all his sins. St. Paul says, "Do you not know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life. If we have been united with him in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection." We join together in the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. O God of grace and mercy, we give thanks for all your loving kindness to all your servants who, having finished their course in faith, now rest from their labors. Grant that we also may be faithful to death and receive the crown of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Old Testament reading is from Isaiah chapter 61. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant to those who mourn in Zion, to give them a beautiful headdress instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the garment of praise instead of a faint spirit, that they may be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Israel will neither slumber nor sleep.
The epistle reading is from 2 Timothy chapter 4. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who is to judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with complete patience and teaching. For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but having itching ears, they will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions, and will turn away from listening to the truth and wander off into myths. As for you, always be sober-minded, endure suffering, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for our gospel reading, which is from Mark chapter 4, beginning at the 35th verse. On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. And other boats were with him. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat, so that the boat was already filling. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" And he awoke and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased. And there was a great calm. He said to them, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ, living together in trust and hope. We confess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father.
the Reverend A. W. Pankratz was born on Friday, February 1st, 1929, in Detroit, Michigan. And he was called into Christ's nearer presence on Saturday, November 7th, this year, in Bridgman, Michigan. Before I begin, a couple of words. First, about a pastor's funeral. Those of you who are regular attendants in church know that the altar pyramids are green this time of year. Soon to change to blue or purple, as pastor would have wanted them for Advent. But today they're red. Historically, when a pastor has a funeral, for his funeral, the pyramids and the stoles are red, the same color they were on the day he was ordained, and he put on his very first stole, a red stole. Red is this wonderful color to remind us of the working of the Holy Spirit. And I have this dove on my stole today to think of the day of Pentecost, when the church was born and tongues of fire came down onto the heads of the disciples. And Peter preached the first Christian sermon, but not the last. I don't know if you ever counted up how many sermons Pastor Pankratz preached. I bet he'd like to have a nickel for every one. The other thing we can't do in this sanctuary because of its design, but and something you would probably never know, but us people think about these things, is when a member of a congregation has their funeral and the casket comes in, they always have they're facing the altar, the feet this way and the head that way, just the way you are today. But it's the other way for a pastor, that his face is facing the congregation the way he was during all the times that he stood at the altar. So I have to tell you, I am honored and humbled to be able to share God's word today on the occasion of this Christian burial for Pastor Pankratz, and I certainly don't feel up to the task, but the Lord will make right whatever I make wrong. Our text today follows a certain theme that you may have already picked up on a little bit. It's from Matthew chapter 4, verses 18 to 22. While walking by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on from there, he saw two brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. And he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. This is for our text. I forgot one more thing in my preface, and that is often at a pastor's funeral, all the pastors in the area attend. And you know, with the situation with the virus this year, that put a damper on a lot of things. But this is, for those who don't know, this is Pastor Liebig. He's a pastor at Trinity Lutheran Church in Glendora. And we all know that the real Lutheran churches are all named Trinity, aren't they? Dorothy and Paul and John and Carla, Samantha, family and friends, grace and peace and mercy to you from God our Father, the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. As I mentioned to you earlier today, I first met Pastor Pankratz sometime in 1952 or 53. At that time, he was a vicar for Pastor Stunkel at Trinity Lutheran Church in St. Joseph. And I was about 1 year old. Can't say he made a big impression on me. But I'm sure he didn't remember me either, if he knew who I was, but I'm sure I must have met him because my family attended there every Sunday until we moved away, and we moved to Three Oaks, and we traveled to Trinity. I remember going to preschool, kindergarten there, and then the most traumatic and terrifying thing in my life up until that time when I was 5 years old is I entered kindergarten Sunday school at Trinity Lutheran School Church in Sawyer. Some of you might know there was a I don't know if you remember it, Don. There was a two-room wooden school on the east side of Flynn Road where the church and the school used to be there. And I went there, and I remember my stomach turning and being so terrified to go to this new church and new Sunday school. But there we remain from, I believe it was 55, in the summer of 55. Or no, it was 56, now that I think about it. My brother was born in 56. He was baptized at Trinity St. Joe in the spring. So he must have joined there in the fall when I started kindergarten. And then we stayed there through my seventh grade year, and then when I was in eighth grade, we moved to Emmanuel Bridgman. So we didn't quite overlap at Trinity Sawyer, but we knew a lot of the same people. And we've forgotten a lot, too. What a wonderful day to think about God's blessings in the world and in his church and in his family today through a son. Now, I looked at the video a couple times, and I was wondering if one of those pictures might have been Pastor's father, and I thought, you know, I just think of how proud a dad would be that his son would go to become a pastor, particularly in those days, not so much today, unless your dad's a pastor, right? And so much so that he sent him off to Concordia to go to high school, already thinking about a pastor, more about that later. And to celebrate today what a blessing God gave your family through a husband and a father and a grandfather. And to the family of God here, a shepherd who had the yoke of office and the shepherd's staff to lead the flock. He did that for 25 years in Sawyer up until his retirement in 1992. For his last 8 years, I was beginning here as pastor here, so we served together in the circuit for 8 years, and he probably came home and he told Dorothy, he says, you should see that new guy at Trinity. Man, I mean at Christ, is he ever, you know what they do over there? Ah, he never said anything like that, I hope. So one of his favorite hymns was, Oh That I Had a Thousand Voices, we got to sing it. He not only sang this hymn, he lived it. One stanza two states this. Arise, keep silent no more. And that was Pastor Pankratz. When it came to the gospel of Jesus Christ and the cross, life and death and resurrection and forgiveness of sins, he could keep silent no more. His life was one of proclaiming to all, wherever he might be, what great things God had done for me and for all of us through Jesus. I don't know when it happened, but one day, a still, small voice of Jesus whispered in his ear, Follow me, and I will make you a fisher of men. And he dropped what he was doing, and he went to school to learn all that he could to be an effective fisher of men. As often was the case in those days, for young men wanting to become pastors, he entered high school with his eyes on the seminary. Adolf would often speak to me of those days and the lifelong friendships that he developed right in high school with other men who had become pastors as well, gone out across our synod to serve. Back in those days, requirements to go to Concordia Seminary in St. Louis were much more demanding than they are today. Pastor had to learn Latin and German and Greek and Hebrew to put his toe across the threshold of the seminary. There weren't any exceptions. You didn't get in through the back door or lower the bar. The bar was high, and over it Adolf went in flying colors. I know he hid it well, but he was a scholar. He knew more about more things than most of us can imagine. He learned philosophy and the liberal arts. He became a Renaissance man, able to faithfully lead a congregation filled with college professors or farmers. Made no difference. And his life was filled with a missionary spirit. He founded not one, but two congregations. One at the beginning of his ministry, Zion Lutheran Church in North Highlands, California, and one after retirement, Living Water Lutheran Church in Mayo, Michigan. Now, here's an interesting story. He built the church in California, and he started with an education wing. Their first services were in the parsonage. And then one Saturday night, kids will be kids. And if I didn't get this story right, Dorothy, just fix it later. But they decided to roast some hot dogs with the shavings of the wood that was in the construction of the new church. And Beaver and Wally and Lumpy and all of those guys burnt the church down before it was finished. And he had to start all over again. I don't know if this was the first time, but it certainly wasn't the last. When it felt maybe to Adolf and to other pastors in situations that maybe Jesus was asleep in the stern on a cushion, and the storm was raging around. Now, I read the paper, the account in the paper of this event, so I don't think this is true. But possibly he thought, teacher, do you not care? I'm working so hard to build your church here, and you burned it down. And Jesus awoke and said, peace, be still. Now, I know some of you are from Trinity Lutheran Church in Sawyer. Now, if you are, it may be a surprise to you. Trinity Lutheran Church in Sawyer is not the jewel of the Missouri Synod. I don't know how many nights he left, maybe a voters meeting or an I shouldn't have looked at him. An elders meeting, and he said, the waves are coming over the side of the boat. And Jesus said, be still. Back to California, he had to start over, but he had almost 500 kids in the Sunday school. You talk about a missionary spirit of reaching out in a way that is almost unknown today. His life and ministry was an echo of the life and ministry of Jesus. His life was dedicated to proclaiming the good news to the poor. The Old Testament lesson today was one I chose in particular because it's from Isaiah 61, 1 to 3, and it is one suggested for a Christian burial, but it is one also that Jesus quotes and reads from one day when he goes to church, synagogue in Nazareth, and Isaiah's scroll is put on his lap, and he reads these words, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to comfort all who mourn, to give them the oil of gladness instead of mourning. And then Jesus said, on this day, these words are fulfilled in your hearing. And pastors have been saying those words to those who are mourning and those who are poor in spirit ever after. And so also, that's what Pastor did to families in the same situation over and over again. The oil of gladness. There's only one way you can proclaim the oil of gladness is to have it yourself. To know that Jesus on Good Friday said, "It is finished. All sins are paid for." It's true what he said to the thief, "Today you'll be with me in paradise." And that gladdens your heart, as it gladdens ours today, that on Saturday, Jesus said, maybe not as clearly, but certainly as truly, "Today you will be with me in paradise." As you know, his vocation was 24/7, 365 days a year commitment. He preached and taught and led worship and administered the sacrament to be a fisher of men, to follow Jesus. He welcomed infants and adults into the kingdom through baptism. He instructed the young and confirmed them in the faith, even though for some of them it was like pulling teeth. Probably not for John and Paul. They were eager students. But those of us who've taught confirmation know that when Jesus says, "Take up your cross and follow me," he included teaching confirmation. He went to the bedside of those who were sick, and he communed the shut-ins. He comforted those who were mourning and stood at the graveside of countless saints. And now he joins with them, and with the angels and the archangels and all the company of heaven, singing, "Holy, holy, holy." All of this is true because Adolf stood firmly side by side with the Apostle Paul, affirming that these words are indeed true. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Now, I have 4 children and a wife. They will affirm that I am a sinner. I wonder if you have had the same observation for a husband and a father. Makes no difference. All those sins are washed away. In God's eyes, he is covered in the white robe of righteousness. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Now, Dorothy mentioned to me that even at the end, Adolf had a sharp mind. It's no surprise to me. He knew more than you would ever imagine. During the dark days of the late 1960s and into the 70s in the Missouri Synod, when it wasn't entirely certain that we as a synod would remain faithful to the Bible, Pastor Pankret played a key role. Maybe some of you know that. Maybe it's a surprise to others. He took seriously Paul's words to Timothy, "Preach the word in season and out of season, even when people with itching ears would no longer endure sound doctrine." Now, I happen to have been in seminary during those days, and I know how difficult they were, and how thankful I am for pastors such as Pastor Pankratz, who faithfully came into the vineyard to be faithful to God's word in spite of the difficulty of the times. And everyone today who is still a member of the Missouri Synod needs to thank men like Pastor Pankratz for keeping us in the word and faithful to the Bible. We knew him as a faithful and caring shepherd, but he was so much more. He's a faithful husband and father. sober-minded, and quick of wit. After serving as the founding pastor of his first congregation, God had other plans for him. He accepted a call to serve at St. Mark's Lutheran Church in Irish Hills, Michigan, and there he met the love of his life. Dorothy and Adolph were married in 1959, and then Dorothy had to take up her cross and follow him to Hillman. To the far north, to the hinterland. Did they have running water back then and electricity? And they were inseparable except for the last few weeks of his life. What a great blessing he had that God granted him a helpmeet to share in the burden of the ministry, to be there to hear his words of disappointment and frustration at working with sinful people, to have encouragement to get up the next day and proclaim the great things that God has done. In Hillman, the Lord decided that being a pastor and a husband was an insufficient task for Adolph. And God granted to Pastor and Dorothy two sons. Together, they raised their sons in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, with the goal of one day spending eternity with them in heaven. He's there now waiting. And then ultimately, God granted him a daughter-in-law. I don't know if he knew what to do with girls. To make sure that he would find out, he also was granted a granddaughter. And then he could proclaim the grateful things that God had done for him, not only in his ministry, but in his family. To be proud of the accomplishments that you achieved as if they were his own. What great things God has done. Boats played an integral part in Adolph's life. His missionary spirit led him to serve as a chaplain for more than 100 cruises to the far reaches of the world. Through these cruises, his ministry extended far beyond the reaches of a small rural congregation in southern Berrien County. He would often speak to me of people that he had touched from all over the world. And if I'm not mistaken, you might still be in touch with some of those people in different places to this day. But I recently learned that he was an exquisite builder of model boats. His heart was never far from the sea. Every Sunday morning, he could look out from the pulpit and see the beams of the church at Trinity in Sawyer. You know, he was instrumental in causing that building to be built. The old frame church, if any of you remember it, was east of Flynn Road, and then it was moved to the parking lot behind Trinity Sawyer. And across the parking lot. And when I went to Trinity Sawyer, we'd play Annie Annie I over the church. I can't believe they let us do that. And we would walk. Well, at first, you know, we had church in the gymnasium, and you can still see dimples in the tiles from where ladies wear their spiked heels into church. Anyway, we went to, and I remember going to chapel. If you go to Lutheran school, you might have sung matins at chapel. I remember going to sing matins in chapel and ducking for the dive-bombing wasps in that sanctuary. I'm so glad that he built a new church there. But when he looked out and he saw the beams and the ceiling of the church at Trinity, and you know what? He could imagine that that represented the ribs of a ship upside down. You see, where you sit in the church is called the nave, like a ship, like the ark of Noah. Like we get our word navy from that. And God used Adolph to bring salvation to countless individuals who were drowning in sin. His entire life was dedicated to piloting the ark to safe harbor of eternal life in paradise with Jesus. To do this, he faithfully proclaimed sin and grace. Now, Dorothy mentioned to me that they were just making arrangements to bring him home. What she didn't know is Jesus was doing the same. And so he brought him home. The arrangements were made on the cross, The contract was signed on Easter morning, and it was fulfilled when the Lord looked at the Lord Jesus looked at Adolf and said, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master." Amen. And now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus our Lord. In honor of all those years of serving as a chaplain and being at sea, we're going to sing the Navy hymn, "Eternal Father Strong to Save." Stand for prayer. One prayer not printed in your folder is one that is in the altar book for the Lutheran hymnal that I'm sure Pastor prayed many times. It has pleased Almighty God to summon out of this veil of tears to our eternal home the soul of A.W. Pancratz. Let us pray. O Lord God, you are the Lord of life and death. You turnest man to destruction and sayest, "Return ye, children of men." We give thee thanks for all the mercies which during his life thou didst bestow upon this, our beloved brother, now fallen asleep. And especially do we bless thee for having brought him to the knowledge of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ. We pray thee comfort the survivors with thine everlasting comfort and cheer them with the sweet hope of a blessed reunion in heaven. Grant to the lifeless body rest in the bosom of the earth, and hereafter together with us all, a joyful resurrection to life everlasting. Teach us all to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom and finally be saved through Jesus Christ, thy beloved Son, our Lord and Savior. Amen. We continue with the responsive prayer. Almighty God, you have knit your chosen people together in one communion. In the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, give to your whole church in heaven and on earth your light and your peace. Lord, in your mercy, grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, and that through the gate of death and the grave we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, your Holy Spirit, that we may lead in holiness and live in holiness and righteousness all our days. Lord, in your mercy, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you with a quiet mind. Lord, in your mercy, grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in the your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, that they may know the consolation of your love. Lord, in your mercy, give courage and faith to the bereaved, that they may have strength to meet the days ahead in the assurance of a holy and certain hope, in the communion of your church, and in the joyful expectation to eternal life with those they love and have departed in the faith. Lord, in your mercy, help us, we pray, in the midst of things we cannot understand, to believe in and find comfort in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Lord, in your mercy, God of all grace, you sent your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, to bring life and immortality to light. We give you thanks that by his death he has destroyed the power of death, and by his resurrection opened the kingdom of heaven to all believers. Strengthen us in the confidence that because he lives, we shall live also, and that neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, will be able to separate us from your love, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our Father, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine in you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.